and his ultimate sacrifice. And to get us going, I thought it would be interesting, at the very least, to look back at exactly where communion came from. And most of you know it started with the Last Supper. And so I thought it would be good to at least check that out. And the reason we need to go all the way back to Deuteronomy chapter 16 is this is not where the Lord's Supper was instituted, but where Passover was instituted for the nation. And I'm going to read through it, and then we'll talk about it, and then we'll go into what Christ did with this ceremony. It says this: observe the month of Abib in celebration of Passover to the Lord your God. For the month of Abib, the Lord your God brought you out of Egypt by night. You shall sacrifice that Passover to the Lord your God from the flock and the herd, in the place where the Lord chooses to establish his name. You shall not eat leavened bread with it. 7 days you shall eat with it unleavened bread, the bread of affliction. For you came out of the land of Egypt in haste, so that you can remember all the days of your life that you came out of the land of Egypt. For 7 days no leavened bread will be seen with you in all of your territory. And none of the flesh which you sacrifice on the evening of the first day shall remain overnight until morning. You're not allowed to sacrifice in the Passover any of your towns which the Lord your God has given you, but at the place where the Lord your God chose to establish his name. You shall sacrifice the Passover in the evening at sunset at the time that you came out of Egypt. You'll cook and eat all of it in the place where your Lord God chose. In the morning, you'll return to your tents. 6 days you shall eat the unleavened bread, and on the seventh day you shall solemnly assemble to the Lord your God, and you shall not do work on it. Okay, see if you picked up some of the symbols. How many days are you supposed to eat unleavened bread? They only said it 3 times.
Seven.
There we go. Does God later use 7? Does Christ use 7 later? Did he use it before? Where do we know the number 7 from? Day 7. What happened on day 7, Bob? Oh, I hear it in the back. That was his day of rest, right? Not only was it his day of rest after the 7th day, but before the crucifixion, the pre-church, the Jewish tabernacle, celebrated on the 7th day, Saturday, right? The church came into existence. We said, no, because of the resurrection, we're going to start on day 1, Sunday. That's kind of where that tradition came from, a 7 again, right? Not only is it going to be unleavened bread for 7 days, but there's also this sacrifice. What was the sacrifice? Anybody know? It doesn't actually say in this verse. What did they sacrifice?
Leavening.
Well, they got rid of their leavening. They also sacrificed an animal, right? Which kind? Was it like it was a pig, right? No? No, I get, did I? Oh, no. Pastor Don's like, don't even. Okay, so. No, it was not a pig. The Jewish nation would not have taken that. It was a lamb, right? They would sacrifice a lamb, and they would eat the whole lamb, and none of the lamb that wasn't eaten could stay in the house. The party started on the evening, right, at sunset. It's interesting because these all sound like really kind of obtuse rules, right? But here's the thing. It came out of Israel's removal from Egypt. If you remember back to that story, remember back to Sunday school flannel boards, you remember the story, all the Egyptians were in captivity, right? And all the plagues are happening. And Moses kept walking up, right, with a big staff, and he says, well, let my people go. Yes, and you'll know. Let my people go. And Pharaoh basically said, no, you can't do it. And then the frogs would come, and then the locusts would come, and then the blood would come into the rivers, right? All of that. All the river would turn into blood, rather. One thing after another. The very last one was death of the firstborn, right? So the last time Moses goes in, he says, you got to let my people go, because this time it's going to be the death of the firstborn of the entire generation, all the sons of Egypt. Pharaoh's heart was hardened. He said, now you're pulling my leg, right? 6 times you were right, the 7th time you're going to be wrong. So Moses goes back to the people, and he tells them to sacrifice the lamb, take the blood, put it over the door. And if the blood is over the door, and if they had their party, they didn't leave the meat inside, they didn't eat the leavened bread, right, then the angel of death would pass over their house and go somewhere else. The next morning, the Egyptians wake up to cries and screaming because their firstborn is gone. And the people rise up and say, we want these slaves that brought this on us, we want them out. And at sunset, they left. Then, Passover is established. So we come to the days of Christ. Guess what the Jewish people are still celebrating? Passover, right? On the first day of the unleavened bread. So how many days away from sunset? How many days is unleavened bread? Seven. Look at this math. I love it. Okay. When the Passover lamb was being sacrificed, his disciples said to him, where do you want us to go to prepare to eat the Passover? You see, Christ was a Jew first and foremost, right? Absolutely, he followed all of the Old Testament law. So they said, where is it that we're going to go to celebrate the Passover? Where would you like to do that? He sent two of his disciples and he said to them, go into the city and a man will meet you carrying a pitcher of water. Follow that guy. Wherever he enters, say to the owner of that house, the teacher says, where is my guest room so that I can eat the Passover with my disciples? See, this is a special occasion, right? And it's going to be very special for Christ when we figure out exactly what this means in the life of Christ. So he himself will show you this upper room, and a furnished area will be ready. Prepare for us there. The disciples went out and came into the city, and they found it just as he had told them. They prepared the Passover. You know, so much symbolism, not only in the Old and New Testament, that sometimes we can just blow over it, right? We glance right past it because we're so used to it. Today, we are going to actually be celebrating communion. We're going to be doing what's instituted right here. And so I'm going to try to walk through it slowly so we don't blow over any of the symbolism this week. Maybe to bring that refreshing bit back. So here we go. Here's the Passover. When it was evening, he came with the 12. They were all reclining at the table, they were eating. Jesus said, truly I say to you, one of you will betray me. In fact, one who's eating with me. And they began to be grieved, of course, this is upsetting, and said to him, one by one, surely not I. They go around the table, right? Anybody ever seen Michelangelo's Last Supper? You ever see the painting, the sculpture, the relief? There's a bunch of them, right? This is a very famous painting, and Christ is in the middle. And he's got a little bit of a halo thing happening. And the 12, he's got six on each side. And it's interesting, this painting is famous for a few reasons. One, because it's a masterpiece because of all the angles and the perspectives and how impressive it is. But a couple things that I always find striking when I see it. One is that there's Roman columns everywhere. We know they're in an upper room, right? Probably not full of Roman columns. Number two, they're all sitting on one side of the table. That's very unnatural. And the third thing is they're all sitting at a table, right? Sitting and standing. Christ is standing, they're sitting. This table wouldn't have been like that at all. There would have been a table that had been fairly low to the ground, so low to the ground that probably you weren't even getting your legs under it. More than likely, you were laying on your side, and typically you lay on your side with your hand on your head, elbow on the floor. And so the person I'm talking to, his head is here, right? The person talking to me, their head is like right. Down. Their head is like right here. And so you would share a bowl with two, three, depending on how big the table was, maybe a few people. You could all reach, you could eat with one hand, and everyone would chat like that. So here, he says, one of you is going to betray me. He's talking about the table. The reason that's important is this. It means that the guy who owns the house isn't going to betray him. Possibly the people serving the food, they're not going to betray him. Whoever brought him over with the pitcher, he's not going to betray him. It is one of Christ's what? His close ones, right? His friends. You know, I have a sneaky suspicion that I can say a very mean thing to Brother Aaron. I can do that and he'd be angry. But I had a feeling that his wife wanted to say something very mean to him and have to be extremely angry because she knew that. probably better than me, right?
Why?
Why is that possible? Why can the people we're closest to, how can we hurt each other more? Why? It matters. They know us. We've invested time. We've invested energy. We've invested love. If we live in the same household, we've invested, right? You know, here, when Christ says, I'm going to be betrayed, I doubt that the disciples were shocked by that portion, right? They were shocked by the fact he said, somebody at this table. Can you imagine the tension in that room? This isn't a theory. He says, the one of you. He might as well have been pointing, right? One of you. So they go around the table, and each one of them says, surely you're not talking about me. Surely this is not me that's going to be the betrayer. Tell me it's not so. And he said to them, it is one of the 12. One who dips with me in this bowl. Some people have summarized that man was one in front or one behind. Possibly it's somebody across as well. For the Son of Man is to go just as it is written of him. Woe to that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better if he had never been born. Now, while they're eating, he took some bread. Before we get into the communion portion, there is a note I want to make. If you follow along in your notes that we provide, you don't have to. Most will take them home and look at them. But if you follow along, it does say that in John 13, which is the same story, it's the one we usually do our communion story from, we find out that Judas got up to deal with some errands, but the other 11 stayed. Anybody know what those errands were? Some of us know. Okay, so Judas gets up and he leaves at some point during this dinner, presumably before verse 22. And so he gets up and he leaves the other 11 stay. Now Judas took care of the money and those things, so it wouldn't be completely odd for him to get up and go pay a bill or him to possibly go buy more drink, whatever it was. So that's not necessarily weird, but after just hearing that someone is betraying, the other 11 had to kind of scratch their head and wonder. So Judas gets up and he leaves, and the supper continues. And here's where it gets interesting. While they were eating, he took some bread. After blessing it, he broke it and he gave it to them and said, take it. This is great unleavened bread. I baked it myself. Is that what he said? And they take it. This is my body. Now notice it was unleavened bread. This is the time of the unleavened bread. When we do communion, I'll share this and I'll cover back up. We use unleavened bread as well. People have asked me how it is that it's all fluffy and not like crackers. It's sourdough. We cheat. It's still unleavened. And not only is it unleavened, but he gives it to them. He says, this is my body. The early church was actually condemned by a lot of societies because they thought that it was a group of cannibals because they always talked about eating the body and drinking the blood. And then when he took a cup, he gave thanks for it. He gave it to them, and they all drank from it. And he said, this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many. Truly I say to you, I will never again drink of the fruit of the vine until the day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God. So he establishes the Lord's Supper right here, and he says, this is my body broken for you. This is my blood, a blood of the new covenant. And they all partake of it together. You know, it's interesting to think that not only was his blood shed, it was shed for many, right? It's a lot easier to believe that you're willing to shed your blood for those closest to you. If Christ had said, I'm going to shed my blood for you 12, at least humanly that would make sense, right? But the fact that he was willing to go for the world, for people he never had contact with, people he never knew. Now, I know he's God, so he knows you, but he never broke bread with you, right? Yet he was willing to die and pour out his blood for you and break his body for you. Also, note that he says, this blood is my covenant, right? There have been a number of covenants up until this point, the Noahic covenant, the Mosaic covenant. There's a few of them, and we can argue which one is a full covenant, which is a half. That's a nice theology question that Patty and Don can have later. But here, he's established a new one. He says, this cup is a covenant in my blood. It's a three-way promise. That's basically what covenant means. It is a promise between people and God himself. Something that can't be broken. And I probably explained this before, but I think it's worth noting one more time. If I were to tell Linda I want to buy your car, and we agree on a price, and I go to pick up the car, and I choose not to pay her, do I go to prison? No. Do I go to jail? No. Is there a fee? No. It's a promise. I broke my promise on the jail. If we do the same thing, yet we go and get a contract first, am I now held liable? That's the difference between a promise and a covenant. And Christ says he's making a covenant in his blood. Then they sang a song, verse 26. And they went out on the Mount of Olives. And Jesus then says another harsh thing. You thought the thing about Judas was harsh. It's going to get even worse. He says this: you will all fall away, because it's written, I will strike down the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered. So not only have they run Judas off, Christ then turns to the remaining 11, and he says, all of you are going to leave me at the end here. You're all going to be scattered, because prophecy says that has to be. And after I've been raised, I will go ahead of you to Galilee. We're going to put a pin right there. Did Christ just predict his death, burial, and resurrection all in one sentence? Yes. So why is it the disciples are going to forget when he dies? What do you think? He's done it about three times in Mark now. Oh, think about that. I'll circle back to it, I promise. Here we go. But Peter said to him, even if, you gotta love Peter. I have to laugh because I'm afraid that I would have been Peter in this situation. Here's what Peter says. Even though everybody else and the other 11 are there, you realize this, even though all of you leave, I will not. And Jesus said to him, truly I say to you, this very night, before a rooster crows twice, you will deny me three times. But Peter kept saying insistently, even if I die with you, I will not deny you. And all the others were saying the same thing as well, right? Once Peter said it, was, oh, me too. I'll die before I betray you, right? Now, this may be a scary question, but has anyone ever been frightened before? Some real, yes, I've been scared. How does your mind work when you're frightened? Do you normally do the most logical thing? Or do you just like fall down and cover your head? Do you run away? I think everybody has their own instinct, but when you're scared, that's what you do, you just fall down. When you're scared, instinct kind of takes over, right? You see, once we get to the cross, it's coming up on Good Friday, if you walk all the way down there with us. Once we get to Good Friday, the disciples are going to go through some very stressful things. They're going to see the person they've been following accused. And not only accused, but then sent to trial and prosecuted and then sentenced and then killed and then buried. And this idea that I'll be back in 3 days leaves their mind, because if they can kill the leader, how well do the followers hold up? Usually not as well, right? And so they're running for their lives quite literally, even if no one's looking for them. They certainly think that they are. And so here, Peter is claiming something that in the heat of the moment, he can't actually pull off. And Christ knows that. I would like to think that there is no animosity by Christ. Yet, if you know all of your friends are going to leave you in your time of need, I think it would be hard not to hold something and not maybe let it show how disappointed you are, even if you know full well that it has to be that way. I have a verse I want to close with before we actually take communion. It's in 1 Corinthians chapter 10. It's just a couple.
verses. I'll read it for you. It says this.
It's not the cup of blessing which we bless as sharing in the blood of Christ. Is it not the bread which we break, sharing as the body of Christ, what we're getting ready to do? Verse 17 is where I want to get to. Since there is one bread, we who are many are one body. For we all partake of that one bread. Think about that for a minute. This idea that Christ gave himself for us, not only is it eternal life because he was that perfect lamb, right? Not only is it eternal life, not only is it an absolute image of what love looks like, but because we're all under the same covenant, it's also an image of complete unity. Doesn't matter what country you're from or what language you speak, or whether you listen to jazz or country western, ultimately Christ's sacrifice is that unifying thing, right? We're all under the exact same covenant. I find it absolutely beautiful. I really do. And not only is it beautiful, the last thing I want to close with is this: a deliverance from a bondage of sin that we had no way of delivering ourselves out of. If you've ever been in a situation where you are perhaps stuck on the side of the road, your car's not running, you wake up in the morning and there's no power in your house, and you don't have the power to fix it yourself, and someone comes to your rescue, what kind of feelings do you have for that person? Usually it's pretty high, right? You're pretty excited about having that person with you. And exactly the same thing is true for you and your Savior. My question that we want to close with is, what is it that you do in your personal life to show your Savior each and every day that his sacrifice mattered to you? And I think it's a tough question. I had to ask myself that question this week. Do I wait till the beginning of each month to remember that Christ died and sacrificed, or do I give a little bit of myself each and every day because of it? I'm not going to ask you to tell me out loud in this room what you do. I would like you to take a little time this week, though, and pray about it. And ask God what it is that you do and whether or not you really remember the way we're called to remember. Well, I'm going to close in prayer. And at that point, we're going to get ready to head into communion. Lord God, I thank you and praise you. We lift you up. We appreciate the sacrifice you made, whether or not we completely understand it or not. God, we thank you for this covenant you've made with each and every one of us. We ask that all that we do and all that we say is honoring you because you're worth it. God, as we prepare to partake of communion, I ask that you help us set aside any struggles we have amongst one another so that we can clearly and honestly see you with a clear conscience this morning. In your name, amen.